Then we'd like to touch upon the services and solutions that you offer, since it's primarily in the service desk. Then maybe if you can sort of highlight the unique differentiators. I will believe similar areas, companies like BMC Software or Manage Engine will be operating. So how would you differentiate yourself from there? Then specifically the verticals where you witness maximum traction. Another question is obviously last couple of years because of the pandemic, the pattern of workload itself has changed. So how that has impacted the service desk? So, and maybe towards the end we will look at the overall Indian software as a service market perspective, and maybe also GoCanse's future business roadmap. So the best would be if we can start with the genesis of GoCanse Software. That would be best.
Sure. So I'll take that. My name is Rohan, and first of all, Rajnish, thanks for talking to us. It's a pleasure to be talking to folks like you. Sudhir and I know each other for over 15, 18 years now. So we both worked with L&T Infotech in the past, and we were colleagues over there. So essentially, sometime towards 2012, we decided we will start something on our own, and we got into a product which was in the collaborative space. So product similar to Slack, so enterprise collaboration software. So we got into that, and we made a few good sales over there. We sold it to IBM, we sold IBM Research Labs. So we sold it to IBM, we sold it to Shell, the Shell Petroleum, we sold it to Broadcom and a few other companies. However, we found that unlike Slack, which went into an organization and then viralized itself within that organization, our product somehow stayed only within, the department or the group we had sold it to. So we realized that whilst we were getting revenue, whilst the product was comparable and even better than Slack in many respects, as our customers told us, however, the lack of virality meant that we had to move out. So we pivoted towards another product, which again Sudhir conceived of, which was more in the asset information space, IT assets within an enterprise. So that was something that we started off, and we had a few good successes there with customers like Prudential and a few more. Again, there we didn't see explosive growth. So after about 2 or 3 years, we pivoted to what we have right now, which is a enterprise class B2B service desk, which the product can cater to customers within the enterprise as an ITSM product. You talked about Manage Engine and BMC Remedy. So we've actually replaced both of them in a couple of large customers. And the product also caters to the customers of the enterprise, which is what Salesforce does. So that's the versatility of the product. And we've been running with this product for about close to 4 or 5 years now. And we have over 30 customers. You talked about the pandemic. And in the pandemic, we've added about 15 customers. So since March 2020 till date, we have added 15 customers. So that's been our journey so far.
So would you be working, since it's a service desk, in a consortium kind of model with the large cloud providers, an AWS or an Azure, or would you work in collaboration with them? Is that the business model, or are these customers you have added, you are saying, do you approach them as a standalone product? So what's the business model?
So it is, you know, we use Amazon or Azure as a infrastructure as a service. We are not dependent on their platforms or, you know, their various other tools. So we use them, we are hosted on an Amazon or an Azure, and customers, in our business, as you know, you can be multi-tenanted or single-tenanted. But since we are an enterprise class B2B, people prefer single tenancy, so that, you know, the security, the scalability, etc., are addressed, customer by customer. So, you know, that's basically the model that we have used in providing single tenancy to our enterprise customers.
So we are using AWS and we are using Azure as a hosting platform more than anything else at this point. However, you know, there are two classes of customers, the larger customers and the SMB market. And where we are going towards is, as Rohan said, the larger customers prefer an independent instance because of their privacy concerns. Of course, the cost is higher, right? You have to pay a higher cost for higher privacy, confidentiality, segregation of data, etc. So they prefer an independent instance, and we are good both on Amazon or on Azure. And depending on where the geography is, because we have customers in US, India, of course, Japan. Australia, Japan, New Zealand, and Europe. So in Europe, people prefer Azure as the platform more than an AWS. In US, it's completely AWS. So depending on the size of the customer, the privacy concerns, we select a cloud, and we are cloud agnostic in that sense, right? Our product works on Azure as good as it works on AWS. Now, coming to the SMB market, and this is where India plays an important role. We are now coming up and we are launching our Vulcan Care product, which is a complete self-service product for customer service. And that will be hosted on either Azure or AWS. We are in the final stages of talks, because once you have that multi-tenanted platform, it's going to be there for quite some time. So we'll choose one of the platforms for the care platform.
What we tend to see now, especially among the larger enterprises, they will not have only one cloud platform today. They will have a hybrid cloud platform. Correct. So there might be an Azure, might be an AWS. They might have a GCP also, or whatever, IBM. And then there will be certain applications on a private cloud, maybe certain applications on a public.
Absolutely.
So in that sort of complicated environment, and that's where even these vendors like Nutanix are playing, sort of helping in that multi-cloud situation. So right. Where does a service desk product like yours fit in that typical, that sort of environment?
Yeah, so today the, the whole situation is that the CIO of a company has become not a chief information officer, but a chief integration officer, primarily because there are point solutions, right? And point solutions, business is driving the decision of a SaaS product as powerfully as a CIO. Earlier, it used to be the CIO who used to make the decisions. Today, the business is equally powerful because these are point solutions. And the CIO has to make sure that the point solution then integrate with their HR solution for users, with their finance solution, maybe the ERP, and they may be on a private cloud, a public cloud, it may be on-prem as well, right? So the challenge for the CIO is how to integrate the data between the different clouds. Of course, there are distributed clouds also coming for an application, right? That's also there. However, what we have seen is, for us, as a customer service, we are at the fag end of a process. a customer has, you know, prospects, then it has customers, then it does the sales, then it does the after sales, and after sales is where we come into picture. So we are consumers of data, right? A service desk is a consumer of data primarily, except that finally the survey results might be fed into some other system, or the analytics may be fed into some other system. So for us, we are primarily consumers, and we work very well with REST APIs. We have exposed all our REST APIs. So today in a cloud world, right, APIs form a very, very strong integration tool. So our architecture is built on REST APIs, which helps whether we want to consume or whether others want to consume our data.
This changing pattern of workloads during the pandemic, one increasingly all across multiple geographies, we had seen a larger work from home or work from anywhere kind of workforce shifting. So what that has resulted in, the way enterprises used to consume IT or their workload, that patterns itself have undergone a change. And since you are at service desk and you are sending it at the fag end point of the process itself, so yep. How has been the impact of this changing workload pattern on service desk, and how have you sort of synchronized?
See, largely the changes have come, have been imposed. It's not that they volunteered for a work from home. It has come as an imposition. At the initial stage, enterprise was not ready for it because their CISO was not sure about the security and safety and integrity of data, especially when it's outside the internet protocol, which they have defined as the safe protocols. So it took about 3 or 4 months for enterprise to convince their CISO that this is going to be the new normal. So you will have to incorporate certain other IPs, internet protocols, as a part of your monitoring mechanism. And that became a challenge initially, but it has become now very standard. So you find the entire move towards digital has been kind of accompanying the change at work from home. What I mean by that is, the driver could have been the pandemic, but the enterprise themselves have decided that it's digitize or perish today. Now, whether it is a pharma company making formulations or whether it's a retail company which suddenly has to close its shop front, but it has to sell through an e-commerce platform. So that is a decision that has been driven. One trigger has been the pandemic, but the second trigger, it has only been possible because of the digitization wave that has spread across.
Yeah.
And we, at the other end, as Sudhir said, we are at the fag end of it. So we have had to sort of, even our own development team over here has been kind of put on alert to work within the confines of the customer's standards, because we can't sort of digress from that, because we'd be in violation of all your GDPR compliances, SOC 2 compliances. So we are bound by a certain compliance regime that has become the foundation for work from home for us.
Yeah. I'll just talk about slightly different angle about the process that you mentioned, right? We are at the fag end of the business process. So yes, from a technical perspective, security becomes a very paramount feature for digital transformation. And especially since customer data is handled by our product, we have to make sure that all the security procedures or the security gates that we have put are working fine. So that was a big change for us to make sure, even in India, right, there is a lot of emphasis on security now. So all those tools had to be incorporated in our product. However, from just a process perspective, we are finding digital zooming through the roof because of the pandemic. What has happened is people are working from home. The first thing is the change in pattern of calling. India used to have a lot of voice conversation, which has gone down because there are four people in the house and people want to use digital means, right? So a lot of omni-channel requirements suddenly shot up, right? People, you can see everybody now, business WhatsApp accounts are growing because nobody wants to talk. People want to just converse through WhatsApp or through a Twitter or through social media channels. So suddenly in India specifically, we are seeing a lot of omni-channel requirements for our product. And voice is going down significantly.
Broadly, I would like to know overall across multiple geographies, what's the total number of customers? Which are the verticals primarily you are catering to right now? And then specifically within India, what has been the sort of the focus areas?
Okay. So customers, as Ron said, we have about 30 odd enterprise customers. These are, so till 3-4 months back, our focus was only on the larger enterprises. So we have split our enterprise market into two. One is the large and one is the SMB. The SMB for us is just starting with the launch of the new product. Till now, we were focusing on the larger customers around the world, primarily the US, Europe, and India geographies. So these geographies, we have 30 odd large customers, mostly in the Fortune 2000, with a few in Fortune 100 also. However, a large customer will have multi-divisions and multi-locations. One of our customers is a very, very large semiconductor company, which has presence in about 40 countries around the world, and they are doing customer service from those 40 locations, right? So for us, where the company is headquartered doesn't matter. It's spread all over. And for us, each business unit is a customer of ours. So we have 30 enterprises, and we, just in number of stats, we are today supporting 5,000 support agents through our platform, through the 30 customers, and about 50 million end users.
And about 7 million tickets flowing through the system per annum.
If specifically we talk about India, how many of these large enterprises are Indian customers, and what is the SMB traction in India?
Yeah, so SMB traction in India is just starting, as we told that we were not focusing. So we had large, so Axis Bank is one of our customers, one of the divisions called FreeCharge. Is using our product for customer support. And you know, FreeCharge is a very large traction where we have thousands of tickets flowing through it, through our system. And we have now started our traction with the SMB market. We have a couple of mid-sized customers in India on dedicated instance. That is because it's a BFSI customer. So if it's a BFSI customer, they preferred a dedicated instance. So we have about 4 customers out of 30 in India today, but our goal is to capture the SMB market
in India.
So these, all these 4 are from BFSI only?
No.
One is in telco. So it's basically a value-added reseller for the telecoms industry.
The rest three are in BFSI.
Yeah.
Which are the other sectors you are targeting? Because customer service will be across retail, multiple verticals.
So retail, e-commerce are areas that we are targeting. Because globally, out of 30 customers that we have, I would say about 17 are in electronic retail. One second. So, you know, so there is, and retail is retail at the end of the day, whether you're selling electronic products or whether you're selling pet food, it is largely similar. The processes are similar, the reverse logistics is similar, the logistics is similar. So we believe that in India, e-commerce and retail will play a very major role for us. Be it small, be it medium, be it large. So that's an area, aside from BFSI, that we will be targeting.
We also have a few manufacturing customers in the 30, where one of the processes is the product returns, the handling of product returns itself. Okay. Not purely customer service through digital channels, but also tracking the product returns, collaborating with the vendors who have been part of the, you know, product making, etc. That's part of the scope. So manufacturing, BFSI, retail, e-commerce are the primary verticals for us.
On the SME part, and specifically for a very cost conscious market like India, what will be your pricing mechanism? I presume it will be agent wise. So agent wise, how the pricing mechanism?
Yeah, it's a global price, right? It's a global product. It will be, you know, customerservice.vulcansoftware.com, right? Whether a person logs in from US or a person logs in from India, the pricing will be global. However, we are going to give India pricing. So depending on the IP, right, where he comes from, there is a possibility of, so, you know, we are at that very position where we have to now finalize the pricing, whether it will be a global pricing or we need to have a India specific pricing, because this concern has come from everyone we have talked to, that India pricing, India is a very price sensitive market. So depending on where the inquiry comes from, based, because it's an online, it's a touchless thing, depending on where the IP is, we figure out if it's an Indian customer and then give an Indian pricing, which can work for them. So that's something we are working on right now for the SMB market, but point taken. I mean, that's one more input for us.
In terms of, if I say the specifically with more India, looking at India, what will be the salient points of your business roadmap? What are going to be the focus areas, and how are you going to sort of, one is in terms of the products itself, then how are you going to market the product in India? What sort of business model would you be following? Would you be working with other system integrators, or what will be the model specifically to penetrate the Indian market further?
The one thing is it has to be multilingual if it's India. We can't base it just on the English language segment. And since we are going into SMB, the product will be used in Raipur as well as in Raichur. So obviously it will have to cater to Hindi, Kannada, Marathi, Bengali, etc. So that's a given. So that said, there will be a lot of, I would say, partnerships, may not be with system integrators, but with local specialists who cater to a certain segment. Like for instance, somebody catering to let's say the logistics industry in Chhattisgarh. You know, they have been all the Kirana shops in Chhattisgarh who sell Pepsi and who sell fruit juices as well as various other items, FMCG goods. So it will be with those kind of organizations that we'll be partnering, as opposed to, let's say, a tech SI. So that's number one, because there, you know, we need market visibility, and market visibility is provided by those kind of guys, because they know their end customer. So that is going to be the channel, maybe a partnership with Hindustan Lever or Coke or Pepsi or one of these kind of guys.
And I understand, but here there is one challenge, a consortium sort of model to reach out to those SMB clusters, what you are talking in maybe tier 2 and tier 3 cities. But sometimes what happens in those consortiums, there are certain players where there is a possibility of cannibalization, who might be offering something similar, some features, not exactly. So that in a consortium sort of cannibalizes each other. So how would you take care of that possibility?
Yeah, I mean, we have our primary goal for 2021 is basically to get a set of customers in India and go with it. I mean, today we'll tie up with channels such as resellers or consortiums, right? And if there is cannibalization, that's a risk we have to take and then see what's the impact on us, right, at the end of it. So, you know, from a perspective of IP, there is no risk of cannibalization. From a risk of features cannibalization, that's going to happen whether we, you know, provide it or not. Anybody can log in and figure out the features, right? So that is not a very big threat for us, because we are using good technology. We are using modern technology for notification, for alerts, for making sure that the customer gets the value that he is paying for. Right?
See, also the integrations that we will offer, it's, I'm not saying it can't be copied, but it will take them some time to make that adjustments to their architecture to ensure that those kind of integrations are seamless and it works with the end users' ERP systems or HR systems or whatever else they have. So by far and large, it's going to be based on tech stack and the feature set that we have, and knowing fully well that this is an area that can be it can be copied.
Yeah. Just give an example, right? One of the thing in India is you use a password, you use a user saying support@anorganization.com, and five people share that user ID, right? That's one way of cannibalization, yeah. Right? So we have put checks and balances in place that, you know, if it's really being used by more than two screens, right? We can limit it to even one screen, right? It will just throw out the next one. Yeah. Right? So checks and balances to prevent that are already part of the stack.
Yeah, of the stack.
So if I may ask, even I think ServiceNow, there are a few other players in that area. So what are your USPs over some of these competitors?
Yeah. So that's where we come from, right? I mean, basically ours is a modern tech stack. And if you look at the market today, there are two clear markets. One is a larger market where ServiceNow and Salesforce play primarily.
Including BMC.
And BMC is primarily for internal help desk more than customer. BMC is primarily into enterprise internal help desk, whereas Salesforce is into customer service, and ServiceNow is a combination of both. The other market is the very small market, which are, you know, used by, which are using products like Freshdesk or ManageEngine. You know, those are the smaller products that are across the SMB market. There is a big gap in the middle where the mid-sized companies really want a ServiceNow but can't pay the price of ServiceNow, and they are not happy with the features of ManageEngine. See, ManageEngine is a volume business. Some of the smaller players are volume business, and that's their business model, right? There's nothing wrong with it. What we want to do is we want to fill the space in the middle, because we are already having features that can compete with Salesforce and ServiceNow, and we have replaced them in several organizations around the world. When we offer our product to the mid-size customers in India, we are offering the features of a very, very large enterprise requirements at the price of a mid-size and at the convenience of a mid-size market requirement. So that's where we want to come and play.
Also talking about the Indian context, when you're speaking of the large enterprises, they will have a CIO or a CISO in place to take care. But what about these mid-sized or these SMB organizations who themselves might not be operationally that tech savvy, and they definitely would not have a CISO? Maybe an IT person would be an admin kind of person only. How would these SMB organizations manage, especially when security is a challenge?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's where we come in. That's exactly, I mean, you have hit the spot saying, you know, in a mid-sized organization, it's not a very, very solid CIO. It's probably an IT head or a support head or an IT engineer who will be doubling up as a decision maker or an admin guy, right? That's where we come in, because in our product, we have put in the best practices. So if there is customer service, we know from our experience, what are the privacy requirements, right, for a customer service? What are the sensitive fields? Which are the fields that need to be encrypted and, you know, made sure it's not even available while in transit or at rest as well, right? So all those features, we have brought it to a level where a IT admin in a smaller organization can understand the impact of it. So we will ask questions. Do you want your customers' names to be encrypted? Now, that's a very simple question. The technology behind it is handled by us. He just has to click a checkbox, right, saying, yes, I want it to be encrypted. Or we say, what are the channels you want? Do you want WhatsApp and Twitter and Facebook and email and an app? Or do you want only two channels to start with and then go to the third channel, right? So we offer them progressive, increments of features, and based on their convenience and based on their comfort level, they can decide to start using the application for a few channels, then expand to other channels, add more security measures. And this is all on the UI. So it's going to be very easy. Of course, we have a help desk that's going to help them out in case they get stuck. But otherwise, we're making it easy for the IT persons to manage it.
What are going to be the highlights?
Yeah, next.
So, one thing is an intelligent bot is on its way out. So that's a critical thing. Second is a lot more certifications, whether it is knowledge certification. We are already SOC compliant. But some more compliances from defense establishments is on its way. So basically, product feature enhancements are top of the mind. Second is more integrations with external entities, be it ERPs, be it cloud providers, be it some platforms as well. So that is the second. And third is, as Sudhir mentioned, the complete launch towards the end of August of our self-service product catered for the small and medium enterprise called Vulcan Care. So that's what is on our plate for the next few months.
Okay.